So, now let's begin with today's event with a brief learning on the principle of humanity. The initial presentation forms part of PHAP's online learning series on humanitarian law and policy. For those of you who are PHAP members and are listening online, this is part of the Continuous Learning Credits Program. Please watch and listen for the numerical code, which I will mention at the end. You'll need that code to access the assessment and earn your credit for the session. With that, it is my great pleasure to introduce our guest expert for this presentation, Dr. Hugo Slim. Hugo is the head of policy at the International Committee of the Red Cross, the ICRC, based in Geneva. Hugo started his career as a frontline humanitarian worker for Save the Children and later worked as a senior research fellow at Oxford. Hugo's books include Humanitarian Ethics, A Guide to the Morality of Aid in War and Disaster, and Killing Civilians, which he assures me is not a guidebook, but actually an analysis of the method, madness, and morality in war. He's eminently well-placed to lead this session, and we're very glad to have him here today. Over to you, Hugo.
Thank you very much, and thank you for such a generous introduction. It's a great pleasure to speak to PHAP members today, and I think PHAP is an excellent project, and I'm really delighted to be speaking to members for the first time all around the world. It's also my first time speaking to a group of humanitarians as a member of the ICRC, so that's a first for me, a personal first. And I'm really glad that we've got such an experienced panel to follow me and probably correct me if I need it. I want to start by a little story. I had a wonderful week earlier this year teaching human rights for a whole week in a high school in Los Angeles in California in the USA. And I had the most incredible experience of teaching classes of kindergarten, children age of sort of four, and right up through the early teens to last year, people of about 18 years old. And in the first session, the opening session, when I spoke to the whole school at once, I gave a little presentation on human rights, and then we took questions, and there were a lot of good and impressive questions from the teenagers. And I saw a little girl sitting on the floor who must have been about six, and she was really keen to ask a question. So I said, please, what's your question? Ask your question. And she said, great confidence, Hugo, what's your favorite human right? And it was a stunning question, because of course there are quite a lot of human rights, and I had to choose. And it was a brilliant question, cut straight to the truth of things. And of course, after a moment of reflection, I chose the right to life. And luckily, she seemed quite happy with that. And I suppose today I'm talking about humanitarian principles. And at the Red Cross and Red Crescent movement, we have seven fundamental principles. And I've been asked to talk about the first one. And I'm particularly happy to be talking about the first one because actually it's my favorite humanitarian principle. And the reason for this, the reason it's my favorite humanitarian principle, is that it is the most fundamental of the fundamental principles. It's also the most beautiful of the fundamental principles. And it's also the most intuitive and instinctive of the fundamental principles. We know what humanity is. It is close to our hearts. We do not have to work too hard to work it out and calculate it in practice as we do with impartiality, neutrality, and independence. So thank you to Mark and PHAP and others for giving me my favorite principle to talk about, and I'll try and do it justice. And if I fail to do it justice, it's not a problem, because you know what humanity is already, because you are human, because you have felt humanity in your life, because you have needed humanity at times in your life, and because you have been humane and humanitarian to others. So even if I fail in the next 20 minutes, you know what the principle of humanity is anyway. But I will try and do four things now. I'll try first to describe the values and the virtue of humanity. I will then try and describe how humanity is elaborated in law and practices. In other words, how it's made concrete on the ground. And thirdly, I'll identify a couple of operational problems and dilemmas with humanity. And finally, I'll just discuss questions of ownership and the universality of humanity as a principle. So to start with humanity, let's talk about the value that we mean by humanity. And quite clearly, humanity is the goal of humanitarian action. And just to revisit the Red Cross definition that you've got in front of you, humanity is to prevent and alleviate human suffering wherever it may be found. Its purpose is to protect life and health and to ensure respect for the human being. So in that definition, we see an obligation to prevent and alleviate human suffering. We also see a commitment to life and health, and we also see a commitment to respect for the human being. The respect for the human being that is often called the dignity of the human being in human rights talk. So in the Red Cross ICRC fundamental principle definition, humanity is framed as an objective. It is a goal. In fact, it is our purpose in everything we do in humanitarian action. And for our ICRC, it is our single purpose. We have no other purpose than to help build and create humanity in armed conflict and other situations of violence. So the Red Cross and Red Crescent definition is one of intention and objective and activity. It describes a virtuous, good action to relieve suffering, to ensure the respect for the human being. But we must go deeper than that, because why is that an important thing to do? Why do we want to protect life and health and respect the human being? Why do we have this humanitarian intention? And behind this objective, behind the objective of the principle of humanity, is a deep value. And this value is human life and the human person. Humanity says two things. Deep down, it speaks of value, that human life and the human person is a fundamentally good thing. We are each precious, and we are all precious. Humanity, therefore, as flesh, blood, and personal dignity, is a fundamental good. We must protect as much as possible. And the second thing that humanity says is that humanity is also a virtue. It is a way to ensure this good thing is protected. So knowing life and dignity are valuable requires us morally, and as I'll show legally, to be humanitarian, to be humane. So in other words, there is a value deep down in humanity, which is the value of human life and respect for the human person. And that creates an operational virtue where it is the right thing to protect and respect the human being. So there is the conviction of humanity, or the philosophy of humanity. But now to my second point. How is humanity then realized and made concrete in the world, in our actions, in our agencies? And the answer to this is that humanity is carefully elaborated in law and practice in three key ways. For those at the ICRC and those of you who are familiar with international humanitarian law and the Geneva Conventions and refugee and human rights law, it's obvious that humanity, the principle of humanity, the value placed on human life and respect for the human being, is the inspiration and driving idea behind international humanitarian law, behind refugee law, and behind human rights law. The principle that we speak of in the Geneva Conventions and the additional protocols of humane treatment is the way that humanity is made concrete in law and practice, prioritizing humane treatment. So how does this humane treatment, this making concrete humanity, how does it happen? And it happens in various ways. The first way is that in law, there are certain legal identities given to people which give them a humanitarian identity. So in international humanitarian law, we have non-combatants, we have civilians, we have those who are order combat, who are identified as protected persons, to be treated with humanity. And in refugee law, we have refugees as a humane category in international law, and refugees are to be treated humanely with humanity. And the same is extended into the guiding principles on IDPs. And in human rights law, we have the principle that everyone at all times is to be treated with humanity and humane treatment. So humanity is very much made concrete and elaborated in specific laws and legal categories of person to be protected. But the second way it is made concrete in law is in law referring to the conduct of armed conflict. So in the Geneva Conventions, conduct must be determined by humanity. The conduct of war must be as humane as possible. And we therefore get humane principles in the Geneva Conventions, such as distinction, precaution, proportion, humane treatment, and protection. So humanity requires military forces to distinguish between civilians and combatants. It requires military forces to take precaution so it does not hurt people and treat them inhumanely unnecessary. The same with proportion, the same with humane treatment for people in detention or in any other situation, and the overriding commitment to protection of the person. These are the principles of international humanitarian law, which are built from humanity. And then thirdly, of course, humanity is made concrete in legally elaborated and required humanitarian activities. And I suppose the three big ones are humanitarian assistance, humanitarian protection, and humanitarian advocacy, which we at the ICRC would call humanitarian diplomacy. So those three activities, assistance, protection, and advocacy, are concrete manifestations of the principle of humanity. Giving people food, helping them with their livelihood, helping people with health, water, sanitation, protecting people, whether in detention in our case or many other situations where people are threatened with violence. These are all humanity in action. This is the concrete steps taken to deliver the principle of humanity in armed conflict. So moving on to the third point, what are some of the operational consequences and dilemmas or problems of trying to operate with humanity in armed conflict? The first operational problem is, of course, that not everybody is trying to operate with humanity in armed conflict. So for a humanitarian agency and for all of you working in different parts of the world, you are often working in the context of major and deliberate failures of humanity, failing in humanity to one another, deliberate inhumane conduct of armed conflict and hostilities, the direct targeting of civilians, rape, sexual violence, summary executions, inhuman detention treatment, starvation, displacement. You are often operating amidst huge and frequently deliberate failures of humanity. So that's the first big challenge to the principle. The second big challenge to the principle of humanity in action is not always deliberate, but it's the restriction of humanitarian action, what we might call blocking problems, where limits are set to humanitarian activity by authorities who may be deliberately trying to limit humanitarian action and the delivery of humanity in armed conflict, but also blocking and restrictions can be more organic and less deliberate. They can be problems of feasibility. It is just incredibly difficult to reach people. It can be a problem of resources. There are not the resources in money or time to reach people in time to show humanity in action. So those kind of restricting problems in humanity can be deliberate, but they can be structural and entrenched logistical or resourcing problems, which I'm sure you're all familiar with. The third area where we face operational challenges and probably more dilemmas around delivering the principle of humanity into action in armed conflict is when we have to balance it with our other principles. And you're going to have seminars for the next few weeks on the other principles. It's difficult to talk of one in isolation from the other. But as you know, very often when you are actively designing and trying to implement humanitarian programs, you are inevitably balancing the core four principles of humanity: impartiality, neutrality, and independence. You're having to make certain choices up and down a scale of how impartial you can be from 1 to 10, how neutral you can be from 1 to 10, how independent. And very often humanity is considered as part of that balancing act. How much are we going to prioritize humanity over impartiality, neutrality, and independence? Is it more important to reach people and save their lives and protect their person as much as we can, even if it means we lose some of our independence and our neutrality, and we are not able to operate impartially over a whole conflict, but only in one area? How do we balance these principles? And I think very often we have to recognize that, as in a game of cards, where sometimes in games of cards you have one suit, whether it's diamonds or clubs or hearts or spades, that becomes a trump, that is a sort of magic card that has priority over other suits. I think we have to recognize, and I think we're right to do this very often, that humanity in many situations acts as a trump principle, that we will accept some compromises on our other principles to deliver humanity in action. So we have the challenge of the trump. But is that trump card, that trump principle, always to be used? And we at ICRC certainly recognize many situations, not many, but several situations in our history and even today when we will not play the trump of humanity, and actually we will withdraw. And we will tend to withdraw and not prioritize humanity over other principles under two conditions. First of all, if we're working with authorities with whom it's clear that they will participate in no concrete steps to help us ensure the principle of humanity and deliver humanitarian action, if there is nothing that they will do with us to help us be humanitarian, that presents us with a real problem. And the second condition is if really we find no common ground of overlapping values, that we really cannot negotiate with them, design a program that is satisfactory and fair and impartial and neutral and to any degree with them, that we cannot yet find a way to do a humanitarian deal with them, then that is another pressing problem. So there are situations, and thankfully they are rare, when humanity will not trump moral compromise on other principles, but actually we will think there is nothing we can do with these parties. We never stop talking to them, we never stop negotiating, and very often we succeed, like many of you, over time. But there are times when we will stop. The fourth area I want to talk about after those consequences, and the last area, is the question of ownership and universality. The background paper for this poses the question of who owns humanitarian principles, who owns the principle of humanity. And obviously, speaking from the ICRC, I want to make a very clear statement that the principle of humanity is universal. This is fundamental to the fundamental principles, that we all share a conviction in humanity and we all share the ability to be humane and humanitarian. Everyone is and can be a humanity activist. And at the UN General Assembly in a couple of weeks in New York, our president is hosting an event called Uniting Around the Principle of Humanity. And the purpose of this is to bring together political actors, humanitarian actors, religious actors, non-religious actors, to showcase the universality of the conviction to the principle of humanity, that it is universal. And as such, at ICRC, we recognize humanity as a common and shared feeling between human beings, but also, politically, we recognize it as an essential principle in international politics and international relations. We want everyone to embrace humanity. We want states and non-state actors to recognize a global contract of humanity as a fundamental basic agreement between peoples, states, armed groups on humane treatment in armed conflict. And the increase in humanitarian action is a sign of this solidifying global humanity contract. And I think at ICRC, despite the deliberate failures of humanity, as you, and particularly you where you are, see around you very often, we feel sure that the movement for humanity is bigger than the movement for inhumanity. And therefore, humanity is a principle for everyone. We need a wide range of humanity activists, and we have them. First responders, neighbors, families, authorities, local authorities, state authorities, faith-based groups, NGOs, CBOs, the military, business, Red Cross and Red Crescent, and UN agencies. And we need this whole range of humanity activists to work in armed conflict these days. And here, of course, we would also want them to work with the second principle of impartiality, which you will be talking about next week. But we want humanity in action to be guided by impartiality. In other words, to be delivered with total non-discrimination and purely with an objectivity of need. So needs-based, non-discriminating humanitarian action, which sees everyone as essentially equal because they share humanity and distinguished only by their need. So to conclude, what I've tried to do in this little session is four things: to understand the value of humanity as our goal and purpose in humanitarian action, to look at how that principle of humanity, that value, is elaborated concretely in law and in field practices of assistance, protection, and advocacy or diplomacy. And third, I've looked at some of the operational problems around trying to deliver on humanity. And finally, I've emphasized the universality of humanity and the importance of being humanitarian and being impartial as a humanitarian, which you'll look at next week. Thank you.
Always very informative presentation by you on the principle of humanity. Also glad that we managed to get you to be able to speak about your favorite principle. I didn't realize that the ICRC allowed people to play favorites with the principles, but I think you've done a very good job of explaining not only the importance of humanity here, but of its fundamental nature, and in particular your discussion of the way in which it trumps the others. Before we move on now to the next part of this event, the panel discussion, I just need to take care of a little bit of business, and that is that there is an assessment code on your screen right now, 4657, and this briefing was part of PHAP's online learning sessions on humanitarian law and policy, and PHAP members are able to take a two-part assessment of their continuous learning credits. So, once the assessments are live, you'll be notified by via email. And please note down this code, that's 4657, in order to complete these assessments. You're going to need that code. Next, just to say that if you look at your screen right now, you'll see a link to the recording of today's event. All materials and resources related to today's event are available at that link that you see on your screen. It will be processed within a few hours after this session is done and then posted there. Okay. So now I would like to move forward to the second part of our day, and that's the panel discussion. I'm very excited to have a diverse panel. I have spent many times on panels where it is essentially humanitarians speaking with other humanitarians, and that's what we have here today, but we also have people who come from different sides of what you might call the great humanitarian project, including the military and the for-profit aid sector. And so I think with that kind of diversity, I look forward to a lively discussion. I've already introduced Hugo. What I'm going to do now is just introduce the rest of the speakers today and then open up the discussion. So first, we have Sir John Holmes. John is currently the director of the Ditchley Foundation. He was previously the UN Undersecretary General for Humanitarian Affairs and the Emergency Relief Coordinator from 2007 to 2010. That's a mouthful. In short, it means that Sir John was the number one humanitarian in the world. He's written a book called The Politics of Humanity, which places him well to talk about that topic today. Next, we have Andy Hill. Andy has worked in the UK Department for International Development, DFID, for 3 years, and is the CivMil, that's Civil Military Advisor, within the Conflict Humanitarian and Security Department's Humanitarian Response Group. That's responsible for UK humanitarian response. Andy has extensive operational experience that includes the Middle East, Iraq, Afghanistan, Haiti, Mali, the Philippines, and recently Sierra Leone. Last but not least, we have Karen Walsh. Karen's in Washington, D.C., so good morning out there, Karen, and to everyone else in the Western Hemisphere. She is the founder and CEO of Bluegrass Development, an international development solutions provider. She has worked extensively in the aid arena with a host of organizations and UN agency, and most recently in Libya, South Sudan, South Korea, Afghanistan, Pakistan, Iraq, Colombia, and Yemen. In particular, I want to highlight that Karen has also worked with Development Alternatives, Inc., DAI, and Creative Associates International, and both of those are for-profit corporations that deliver aid. And the reason I raise that is that often in humanitarian circles, you will hear that while the principle of humanity is universal, as Hugo just explained, the use of humanity as a way in which to define the motivation for our actions in humanitarian action differentiates us, distinguishes us from other humanitarian actors. So that's one of the topics I think we want to open up today, along with some others that Hugo has begun to talk about. And what I want to do is right now go to we've been talking about this principle of humanity as something universal, and it is something that the not-for-profit, the NGO community holds very dear as a way of distinguishing itself, for instance, from the for-profit aid sector. I guess, do you buy that? It seems like a bit of a challenge that we're motivated by humanity and you're not. What do you think about that, Karen?
Thanks, Mark, for that lead-in. I think you're asking me to come across to the audience and say, well, there is no distinction. In fact, I think that's something that we need to be talking about. I think Sir John started saying that having a humanitarian principle is clearly not enough in this day and age. Good intentions are clearly not what the world wants to see. A commitment, we should all have that commitment if we have to reinforce that each and every single day inside the humanitarian community. That's fine. In the not in the for-profit world, it's an assumption this is what you're doing. I think the idea when I looked at I went across to a lot of the different for-profit worlds that do intersect to the humanitarian world, and in their mission and value statement, they are very different from the NGO world. The NGO world says we have a mission to help people wherever they are in need. Well, in the for-profit world, that's not enough. How are you doing it? Let's quantify it. Let's qualify it. Let's really show what we're doing. Do we have integrity? How are we fiduciary responsible? Will we have results? And I think that's this professionalization that we're no longer allowing people to not think of the humanitarian sector as being a foundation for the future of the longer term development. So what happens in those early stages could be detrimental to the future of that development process. And quite frankly, we've seen what's happened in Iraq and Afghanistan as clear examples of when the foundation is ruined by those who are not looking towards a 10-year solution and focused in on just the immediate work at hand. I think we are losing that precious time, that opening in which we really need to think how we engage both that short-term and long-term community to understand that together this that trajectory needs to start from the beginning. So on a
That's really interesting, Karen. Let me just follow up on that, though, very quickly. Is what you're saying that humanity, to hold the principle of humanity dear, we need to be able to do the things Hugo talked about, like deliver assistance and medical care and protection in the short term, but we need to also recognize the importance of that the potential for long-term development in those very same populations and adjust our working accordingly?
Absolutely. In fact, I think that's probably one of the impediments of why we as different communities have not engaged, because at what point should that short-term assistance be then transitioned into longer-term assistance or scaled back in which we can allow nations themselves, nascent governments, nation institutions start to take over? Because ultimately, the people themselves in the communities, all the way up to the governments, must then be accountable to those they serve and their constituents and their citizens and their communities. And if we keep putting in that barrier of forcing these institutions that should be the sustainable ones, not ourselves as humanitarians or not or for-profit firms, but the governments themselves to then take on that burden, it's a problem. We are not, it is fine to let people fail, but let's be letting them make those baby steps instead of wholeheartedly taking over all of the systems, all of the work, and not allowing people to grow.
Okay, thank you for that, Karen. I note that you will all be able to see on your screen that a full 94, or now it's 95% of you, believe that the principle of humanity applies to the private sector actors. A few minutes ago, I'm going to go to you now, Andy. A few minutes ago, almost 81% of the participants who voted felt that it applies to military actors. Maybe, Andy, you could tell us a little bit about, in these crisis areas where the military is also providing aid and assistance to people, how do they deal with the principle of humanity?
Thank you for that, and good afternoon to everybody. I think to come back to something that I was reminded of recently, and that is that what motivates people to join the military and be part of such an organization. And it is, in many instances, a desire to serve a community perhaps, to serve a nation, and to be part of a force or organization which is very proud of its actions that it carries out. To that end, loyalty also must be to to upholding the principle of humanity. And some of the most, if you like, humanely focused people that I have come across, both in the military and civilian world, obviously are listening in right now, but there are many that aren't. And I think it would be mistaken to think that members of military force, of whichever nationality, are not humane and focused on upholding the principles of humanity as a principle. And so I think that, and really interesting to see that Hugo accept that within his universal definition, he included military within that, and that it is great, intuitive, it is instinctive, and it is sometimes to the frustration of some members of the military because of their inability to respond in a neutral, impartial manner, that they can't, in fact, sometimes do more. But as we all understand, there are very practical reasons why that can't happen. But certainly the overriding principle of humanity does take over. I haven't come across people, whether it be, as I say, those who are responding to a crisis, who don't put humanity at the forefront of their thinking.
Thank you, Andy. Let me come right back to you, though, and just, you know, obviously the members of the military and armed forces are they're human beings and they're acting with humanity and they hold humanity very dear. But, you know, is humanity the motivating factor when the military, for instance, distributes food and assistance? And do you recognize that there are differences there in what actually is the reason for the military's actions when they deliver aid and the humanitarians' actions? Or is that just, you know, an old stereotype that I've been told?
Excuse me. I think that direct assistance is perhaps, we are very much in last resort territory there. Certainly, my experience is that militaries are, they have and sometimes the unique capabilities to be able to offer support, to be able to offer facilitation, logistical support, for example, and so on. I think when, and certainly in the recent years, militaries have been very content to support the humanitarian community in enabling aid and support to be delivered to where it's most needed, and then back off. And by that I mean, if there are other actors around available and competent to deliver direct aid and support, then militaries should back away and allow the NGO community and international organisations to conduct their business. But I think everybody would accept that there are times when their support, equipment, personnel, etc., is needed to support that effort.
All right, thank you, Andy. I understand that we've got. I understand we don't have Sir John Holmes. So let me go back to you, Hugo. You've just heard what Andy and what Karen have said in terms of how the for-profit sector and how the military look at the principle of humanity. Any comments there on you know, I do believe that what they're saying essentially is what you said, that it's very universal, but they take they employ it in very different ways in looking internally at their actions. Hugo, do you want to take that up?
Can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you.
Can you hear me? Sorry, I'm not very good at technology. I don't know if it was me or not. Anyway, I was saying that I think what Karen said is very important, that actually, you know, we can judge ourselves on our intentions to be humane, to be humanitarian, but effectiveness is absolutely key. And that's where the other principles that you're looking at later in the series come in, impartiality, independence, neutrality. But more importantly, that's where the principles of the code of conduct come in terms of we do things in a certain way that respects people, that delivers what they need, that is relevant, etc., timely, coordinated. So humanity is a good thing, but effective humanity is the right thing. And then I think Andy's making a very important point, and you know, I totally agree that if we agree that humanity is a universal feeling and ideal and drive, then we recognize that everybody has it in certain situations. We know we can lose it too, but many people have it. And if I think of military and businesses, I would expect them to have that in certain situations. I mean, at the ICRC, we have worked for 150 years to work with military forces, armed groups, government forces, to
work out how better to be humanitarian in the way they conduct hostilities. So it's core to our conviction that that's what's possible and what should be done. But I think the other point that both Karen and Andy are making is that we're rather lucky as humanitarians because we only have a single intention around humanity. All these other groups, whether it's the military, who are also trying to win a war or win a counterinsurgency or whatever, have other intentions, and businesses have the intention of making money, and we do. So it's quite possible to have two intentions at once, but of course it's harder, and we should respect, I think, people who are having to balance two intentions.
Good afternoon, Ditchley Foundation.
It's very common that in multi-mandate NGOs, we have the same problem. People who are trying to deliver on a humanity objective and a development, peace, justice objective. So in a sense at the ICRC, I realize we're in a privileged position that we have a single intention around humanity. Others don't have that luxury. Their moral and operational life can be more complicated, but the intention to humanity is still common to them all.
Thank you, Hugo. I'm going to come back to Andy with a question that's come in from the audience, and I'm going to pick up on what Hugo just said about the idea of humanity sort of being, you know, we all have this in common, and he was speaking of the military and the for-profit sector, but got a question from Alan who says, you know, Andy, in some ways you're talking about the UK military perspective, but there's other militaries around that seem to operate in very different ways. And some of those could hardly be called humane. Do you have any comment on that? I think it's a really important distinction to be made here.
I think in response to that yes, you're right. My experience is such. However, there are many nations, and I would include the UK very much in this, that is assisting other nations in their preparedness, understanding and application of support to these sorts of humanitarian crisis, to put it in that word, and working with other organizations, working alongside the likes of the UN and OCHA. We like to think that we contribute to those discussions. I've just recently returned from a trip to the other side of the world, where we've been involved with discussions of about 30 other nations, and everybody is learning lessons at all times. Really interesting, some of the lessons that have come out of the recent Nepal response, where there was a great some 17, 18 different nations contributing to that response, and all did it in a slightly different manner, according to their own policies. And there are lessons we can learn from each other in that regard.
Thank you, Andy. Let me just stay with you for 1 minute on this principle of humanity. And I think in Hugo's presentation, he really talked, you know, about, well, this very, very human, you know, sentiment and principle and value, and its humanity. But then again, he also talked about the fact that the ICRC then takes this human value and makes it, you know, the all overriding organizational purpose. And I guess we can all agree that individual members of the military have, can have as much humanity as, a nurse or a doctor or a feeding specialist or a water and sanitation specialist working in a humanitarian crisis. But what about the military as a body, as an organization itself? How does humanity get translated into the military at that level? Because I think what we're seeing in some of the comments is that people would draw a distinction there about whether or not the military actually is able to put humanity in the front of things, or whether it has military objectives in the front of things, which might explain why the military might deliver aid in a place like Pakistan or Afghanistan, where it's active, but it's certainly not going out of its way, for instance, to the Central African Republic or somewhere that is, you know, one of those corners of the world where it is not of strategic importance.
Sure. the military is an extension of political will. It is the last resort in that regard. No, I wouldn't agree that the first overriding objective would be that of, you know, for a military force, would be that of humanity. Military are there to perform a particular task. Sometimes that could be a very unpleasant ask, but nevertheless, that's what they're there to do, to defend a nation, defend a nation's interest. So that would be their overriding priority. But within that, it comes back to the point of whether or not you can have two sort of priorities. Within that, and certainly speaking from the UK perspective, they would do that being extremely cognizant of the principles of, for example, proportionality, the identification of combatants and non-combatants, the lack of or the providing protection within a sort of conflict environment, so which is can be extremely challenging. And commanders, senior and junior, understand and indeed receive training on a very regular basis in the principles of the law of armed conflict and others. So that's how they would, I think, couch it. Hope that's clear.
All right, thank you, Andy. I understand now that we have John back. John was out delivering humanitarian assistance and is now able to connect with us. John, I'm really sorry about the technical difficulties, but if you want to get back to what you were saying, we missed quite a bit of it, so I wouldn't mind if you just started with really what you were going to answer in terms of the universality and some of your thinking around this principle of humanity.
Okay, thank you, Mark. Can you hear me now, everybody?
It sounds really good.
Good, okay. I don't know how much you heard before, but I'll start again. What I was saying was that I was very much agreeing with Hugo that for humanitarian organizations and humanitarian workers, this principle of humanity is absolutely fundamental and has to guide everything else. And it's what distinguishes humanitarian organizations from other organizations who, and this goes back to what you were just discussing, I think, with Andy, would aspire to do whatever they do in a humane fashion, but humanity is not their overriding motivation or their overriding principle. And that obviously applies to the military, but it applies to people who are operating in commercial situations and others as well. So that humanity, that driving fundamental force of humanity is what distinguishes humanitarian organizations and workers in action from other kinds of action. But what I was also going on to say was that, of course, you can never really say that humanity by itself is enough to guide what you're actually going to do in any given context. And I was, there were three ways in which I was going to condition this principle, if you like, at least for the sake of the debate and to be a little bit provocative. The first one was whether idealism in the sense of commitment to humanity is enough. It's a very important motivating factor, the most important motivating factor for humanitarian action, the moral imperative, if you like. But you also have to recognize that it's not enough in some circumstances. You also have to be well organized and professional about what you're doing. And that can sometimes lead to issues where organizations, particularly big humanitarian organizations, appear to have lost some of their idealism and lost it in bureaucracy and rules and regulations. So the point I was trying to make there is that there is a difficulty but also a need to try to balance the original commitment and the humanity and the idealism with the need for professionalism and training and regulation and rules and all the rest of it at the same time. So we need to bear that in mind. Secondly is the question that Hugo raised in his introduction, which is how do you react when you want to try or you have to try to balance this overriding principle of humanity with other principles behind humanitarian action, such as independence and neutrality. And I think this is a genuine problem, and we need to face up to that problem head on. It may be rare that one has to make the choices, but these situations do happen. And the particular example I have in mind, and I lived through it with great sort of personal difficulty and pain, was the end of the war in Sri Lanka between the government and the Tamil Tigers, the rebel movement of the Tamil people, if you like, in 2009, when the LTG, the Tamil Tigers, had with them, as they retreated into a sort of pocket of land, a huge number of civilians, and the question arose of how you're going to give protection and assistance to those civilians, and should you be cooperating at all with a government who were essentially part of the problem and not part of the solution, even though they claimed at the time to be conducting a humanitarian operation to rescue those civilians. Now, the conclusion we reached in that particular case, and the ICRC were not different in that, in a way at least from the UN, was that despite the difficulties of acting, despite the disadvantages of cooperating with a government who we thought were behaving appallingly, it was better on balance to stay there and to do what we could for that civilian population, both before the end of the war and afterwards, rather than pulling out on principle. But that was a controversial decision at the time, has remained a controversial decision since, and we can discuss that, whether what we did was right or wrong, but it's a practical example of the difficulty when different principles appear to conflict with one another. And the third area I wanted to mention was another area where you might say that the principle of humanity is necessary but not sufficient. What I mean by that is that it may guide your actions, but how far should your actions also be taking, even as a humanitarian organization, be taking into account the wider effects of whatever you might be doing? And let me just give you three examples of what this might mean. The first is very current in Europe, which is the refugee stroke migrant crisis we're currently going through, with very large numbers of people arriving on European shores who are fleeing the conflict in Syria or problems in Eritrea or whatever it might be, Afghanistan, different parts of particularly the Middle East and North Africa. Now, humanity dictates that we have to rescue people if they're trying to make this crossing, and we have to treat them decently, and we have to imbue all we're doing with humanity. But the question is then, is that a sufficient response to this crisis? Is there a requirement for humanitarian organizations to take into account in what they do and what they say the wider political context of the problems about immigration into Europe and the political nature of the political problems that gives rise to in each country? Or is that someone else's problem to worry about, and humanitarian organizations should only worry about dealing with people in a decent way and giving them assistance and so on? Second, similar sort of problem arises or can arise in particular kinds of aid situations where you are trying to help people and you are giving them what you think they need and they want, but actually you need to be very careful that you're not doing long-term damage in the process. Now, there's a classic example of this is food aid. Food aid is absolutely vital in some circumstances where there's no food on the markets, no food available, people need food to live, it's very basic. But as soon as you start to do that, and particularly if you're doing it in circumstances where there is food being grown locally, the danger of undermining local markets, undermining the local economies, and so on and so forth is very great. So you need to be very careful about when and where you use food aid, and maybe as we kind of come to learn over time, using cash or vouchers is a much more effective way of doing that, because it doesn't have that effect of undermining the local economy and undermining local farmers. What I'm saying is the desire to help people is not enough by itself. You have to think about it very carefully about what the longer term effects might be. And a related point, and my last point, is that humanitarian aid in certain circumstances is absolutely needed and may be needed over very long periods of time. But at what point does giving that aid start to give rise to other problems? You're driven by humanity, you're driven by your commitment to help people, but over time you may be causing other problems. And an example would be for in Darfur, in Western Sudan, where we've been, the humanitarian community has been dealing with the consequences of the crisis and the conflict in Darfur for 12 years now. We still have a very large number of people in camps who are now willy-nilly aid-dependent, unlikely to go home, and we have unwittingly, for the best of reasons, created a problem which we have now great difficulty in dealing with. And you might say the same thing about, and I'll give a different example about the area, a particular area of Uganda called Karamoja, where the World Food Program were giving aid over 40 years to people who needed that food, were never able to transition out of food aid, and in some senses, for all the right reasons, as it were, for all the right motivations, may have succeeded in creating more problems or creating other problems in the course of giving that aid. So my point, as I say, is not to undermine the principle of humanity, but to say that it's, it always has to be combined, at least with knowledge of the wider consequences of what you're doing and the wider context in which you're doing it. And the fundamental question which often arises for humanitarian organizations in trying to put this principle into practice is, how far is it not the problem of humanitarians to worry about these other factors, it's the problem of politicians or armed forces or whoever they might be, or should we be worrying about the consequences of our actions in the real world at the same time and moderating them when we think they are going to cause those problems? Let me stop there.
Thank you, John. First, very interesting, but also thank you very much for really helping make, using those examples to help make your points very concrete, because I know people appreciate that. Karen, I'd like to come back to you, because, you know, John, one of his first points that he talked about was just this, well, almost contradiction between idealism and being motivated by idealism and professionalism. And he didn't say it's a contradiction. What he was asking is idealism enough? And you and I have talked, and you don't think idealism is enough. And I'm wondering if you've got some examples where you can, you know, for instance, out of Haiti, where idealism wasn't enough. And how is it that you tackle that as a, in the for-profit sector? Do you place being professional above, for instance, the principle of humanity in terms of it being an overarching principle that drives the organization forward?
Thanks, Mark. Again, these are not softball questions at all. I was just recently in Haiti and also in Lebanon this past month, looking at two different examples of the humanitarian issues at hand. And a lot of it has to do with that transitional phase. And I think what Sir John started talking about, is it enough? What is the idealism? What hurts? What helps? How do you continue to move a nation forward? And I'll start with Haiti. We're right now looking at alternative ways of bringing aid assistance into Haiti, and one of the programs we're working with right now is with IOM, bringing Haitian farmers of farming cooperatives throughout Haiti to the United States as workers, as H-2A visa workers. And it's a very controversial program right now within Haiti and the United States, just because the recent past track history with bringing Haitians in for laborers under visas has not gone too well, and there's been a problem. So this is the pilot program that was just commenced this year. And what we're seeing is that we talk to people, and that trickle-down effect of what happened after the earthquake and now continuing on, and there are pockets of getting people out of camps, but it's that next phase. How do you go from that humanitarian assistance piece into a longer, sustainable, gradual push forward? And if you do not have humanity and want to help the Haitians and want to see something else change, a new idea, something working that may not be seen as typical humanitarian crisis, you're at a loss, because we have to come up with new ideas and generate things that are not just traditional, because it's not working. So this is something different for Haiti that we're seeing work, and we're hoping the pilot works out. Now in Lebanon, on the flip side, was out there, and actually I was working with the Lebanese armed forces on humanitarian law aspects, especially along the border guards and what Lebanon's doing. I don't think any nation other than Jordan has the amount of refugees per population that Lebanon has, and I applaud the Lebanese military, and I think actually a lot of the NGO workers that I've talked to out in the field have been looking at how has the Lebanese army actually helped to keep the stress, the country from imploding and allowing in 2 million refugees and more that are unaccounted for inside of Lebanon. And what we've talked about were their stressors and strains. And as a for-profit group, the military was very concerned that they would have a very different message coming from them, from the NGO community. Instead of asking for solutions, they thought they were going to be lectured. And unfortunately, that is a bad perception around the globe for that to happen, but that was the Lebanese army's perception, which is why I went in there, and we were able, which was wonderful, to bring in ICRC to talk to them about armed conflict issues that they didn't talk about before. And because it was this amalgamation of the for-profit, the non-for-profit, ICRC, the military, we were able to bring in a lot more issues because it was seen as a more of an open forum, a collaborative forum. And I think perhaps in places where we need to get new ideas, in the idea of humanity or human rights, we need to have a more generous forum that allows different viewpoints in, but without a more directive, you're doing the wrong thing. We all have to find solutions. So how are we going to do this as professionals to help those who need crisis without pointing the finger and saying you're doing it wrong? We know people are stressed. We know people are having a hard time. How do we support that with good ideas and solutions to make sure that the results that we need out there for the globe come from a place where humanity is respected, but and that is enforced through collaboration and not from different camps pointing fingers? Thanks, Mark.
Thank you, Karen. Just for everybody, you can see that at the bottom of your screen now, we've got a poll up there on whether the principle of humanity relates, how does it relate to the call for increased professionalization and professionalism in humanitarian circles? I want to stick with you, though, Karen, on that topic before I go back to some other panelists, because you seem to be saying, and this is picking up on what Sir John just talked about in terms of the transition phase, where it seems that humanitarians might hang on too long, just in this stereotypical way of giving assistance, and not trying to make that move to development where maybe people are being held more responsible and being involved in a more participatory fashion. And I'm wondering, is that what you're getting at there, that at the nub of this professionalization, there needs to be a better understanding in the humanitarian circles of that transition phase, because it's a phase we see in many of the ongoing complex emergencies, that it is neither a context that is completely development bound, but at the same time, also not a context that is wholly in an emergency phase.
Well, I want to state that first of all, that there is an absolute need for that humanitarian intervention globally, onset of crises or disaster, man-made, natural-made, whatever. But what we're not looking, and this is where I think for myself, is that we need to start identifying what are the levers that would help communities, individuals, governments get away from that assistance. And I don't think that we take it away completely ever. I think there will be vulnerable populations forever who will need more assistance than, say, those who can get to that next level, to that transitional piece. However, if we're not seeing that we shouldn't be there, if we don't evolve ourselves into thinking, how do we get to sustainability? How do we get out of this? How do we move? Maybe if we concentrated on getting governments to stop the crisis so they can rebuild their societies rather than allowing it to go on for 10 years, what if that focus was and I'm saying the entire community, from the NGO, for-profit, governments, military, international bodies are starting to focus on to stop the conflict in these areas so that we can get to that next phase. And if we're putting more time into allowing people to build larger and larger areas of displacement internally or externally, how are we helping these governments to actually understand that they still have a responsibility to their people, as not just the humanitarian global community, but the governments themselves, of that there needs to be resolutions, and maybe that's through sanctions. I'm just saying sanctions, political discourse, whatever we need as a global entity to start getting people to the table with our allies. Should the UN be proposing this? We need to bring more tools to stopping this, because a 10-year war in the Middle East, again, just the lives that we're destroying, we need to start coming with a lot more resources to the table to end some of these issues. And if we're not, as humanitarian community, looking to how that ends, we're in trouble. We're breaking at the seams. The money's not there. What are we going to do next? Thanks, Mark.
All right. Thank you, Karen. Interestingly, if people look at the poll down there, that humanity and professionalism are equally important seems to be winning. Hugo, I'd like to come back to you with and pick up a little bit on this thread of the discussion. John talked about, Hugo, you talked about, I guess most of the people have talked about, the fact that often we have the principle of humanity colliding or coming into tension with impartiality, neutrality, independence, the other principles. But what John brought out is the way in which it comes into, especially maybe in these transition stages, into contradiction or tension with, for instance, an ideal or a goal such as sustainability. And I'm wondering how in the ICRC do you handle those sorts of issues where, you know, humanity says we need to respond to, for instance, a health crisis here, rather than try and devote our resources to building the healthcare system. So how in the ICRC do you look at the relationship between humanity, for instance, and sustainability?
Thanks. That's a good question. I think we, you know, we're doing different things in different times and different places. And if we look at a lot of our work in protracted conflict, areas of chronic conflict where armed conflict has been a feature of these societies for many years, if we look at places like South Sudan or increasingly Syria and Iraq now, Afghanistan, I think we find that very often we are finding that the best way to work long-term in those situations is to sustain some kind of basic services. So a lot of our work will actually be around sustaining health services, basic services like that. In the Middle East, we find ourselves responsible for huge infrastructure, development infrastructure, and we're really trying to stop it degrading beyond the point of being absolutely useless to people. So a lot of our work is about sustaining infrastructure, sustaining services for people. And I think we've got quite an old-fashioned idea of humanitarian work.
Your microphone has been turned on.
We have rather an old-fashioned view of humanitarian action if we think about it between as relief, not development, because a lot of humanitarian work is actually about sustaining services over the long term, and if you like, trying to hold the remnants of development infrastructure for people. So sustainability is important. I think if we look at the code of conduct too, you know, going back to this point of John's, that humanity is, you know, necessary but never sufficient as a moral guide and a practical guide in humanitarian work. We have to look at the code of conduct, which requires us to be sustainable. We have to think about what we do now and what that means for longer term effects in people's lives. And also, if I think of what we're doing in South Sudan at the moment, you know, we're leading a courageous and interesting program of trying to sustain basic veterinary services for people who are highly dependent on cattle and livestock. So again, that is us thinking, what's the best way to help these people? And we know it's going to be long. So what is the best way to help people sustain their livelihoods as well as their health and life in these situations?
Thank you, Hugo. Do you feel that working in terms of being able to deliver on goals of sustainability for people where that is the most important, you know, where that's the most important need on the ground, is that something a humanitarian should be taking up, or should they be stepping aside and looking for, you know, urgent emerging needs and allow those, for instance, development actors to be taking up that kind of work? I'm trying to get it.
That would be ideal, wouldn't it? But in many of the hard to reach, highly contested areas that ICRC works in, we find that, and this has been a pattern of our work for many years, we find that development infrastructure, development services and investment has withdrawn either because of the conflict, it's just too dangerous, it's been destroyed, or there might be a sanctions regime in place where, in fact, development investors cannot engage. Most often, it's just simply felt to be too dangerous for development actors to engage. So we find ourselves in this situation of trying to sustain basic development infrastructure and services, but we do it with a humanitarian end to keep people alive and protected through these long conflicts.
Thank you, Hugo. Andy, we haven't forgotten about you being there. I'm just wondering, Andy, if you could comment a little bit. I want to stick with this topic of professionalism for a moment. And, the military certainly plays a high degree of importance on professionalism. To your knowledge, do they look at professionalism also in the delivery of aid, or is it more along the lines of their military obligations, and how do you view that fitting into the aid activities that militaries are doing? And I guess one of the questions would be, are they training for things like running helicopters in earthquake response or typhoon response or something like that?
Okay, thanks. Gosh, there's a lot there. Yes, absolutely right. Culturally, professionalism is extremely important in a military environment. But I would say not only military professionalism, but also employment professionalism. And what do I mean by that? If we take the engineers as a subject area, and I look to our UK response within Sierra Leone to the recent Ebola crisis, the ongoing Ebola crisis, in fact. The UK government employed and asked, with the agreement of the Sierra Leonean government, for us to build, in fact it was circa 600 beds with Ebola treatment centres. Now, we used military engineers to support that activity because they brought quite a lot to the party, and they didn't necessarily do the constructing themselves, but they oversaw local contractors building those treatment centres. They were built to UK standard, and it was the designs were done by UK military engineers and so on. Now, for a number of reasons, partly down to speed, that was deemed to be an extremely positive use of military resource. And we are now where we are in Sierra Leone. And we're obviously now looking at handing those facilities on and back to the government. So there are areas within military that are not necessarily all about war fighting, so on, that can be brought to use. But I take the points that have been made with regard to development actors, in regard to the use of military in that sort of environment. I don't think the UK government sees employing military in that type of role as a preferred option. I'm trying to think whether I've ticked off all your points there, Mark, or whether there are any others. Ah, yes, the training. Now, it's fair to say at the moment in time that response to whether it be a natural crisis is not a confirmed military task. So, is there specific training done to train for those sorts of environments? No. Is it wrapped into other activities? Yes, i.e. when we train helicopter pilots, they're trained for all environments. The answer to the question is no, it's not specifically trained for. Will it be built into training exercises? There is normally a component within most military exercises where there is some degree of humanitarian crisis that the military will train to respond to. But that's very much the theoretical rather than practical. Over to you, Mark.
All right, thank you, Andy. I just want to mention that there's quite some debate going on between some of the participants in the chat. around this issue of the military's involvement in humanitarian assistance. There are some who believe, and I'm reading Sully and Sindhuan, contribution, true humanitarian assistance cannot be delivered by the military. They probably have other roles like security, rescue, and disasters, etc. But still, they need to respect humanitarian principles as they do so. But Daniel disagrees with that, because in some locations, especially like where the local militia are harassing or killing aid workers, they may be the only assistance givers. So just to let you know, Andy, that there's a difference of opinion out there, and it's an interesting one. John, I'd like to come back to you. I'd like to shift off this topic, professionalism, and come back to something that Hugo first raised, and it has come up in a number of ways, and that's your second point, and that's how to balance with this principle of humanity with the other principles. Hugo talked about using the trump card when really he described a couple of situations in which it's pretty clear that humanitarian assistance is just impossible, where there is no negotiable room for humanitarian assistance. At the same time, I'm wondering about all the other situations that aren't quite so black and white. For instance, where humanity says, yes, let's deliver aid to these people, but the government's saying you can't go any further. The government is not giving permission, in other words, a blockage to going to, let's say, the northeast corner of the country, where your information says that the needs are greatest up there. In other words, impartiality is saying to go up there. And I'm just wondering, can you give us some examples? I know you've been part of these discussions with governments around, how do different agencies treat that kind of a dilemma where it's not quite so black and white? And how long should agencies, withhold delivering assistance in, let's say, government-friendly areas in order to try and get permission to go to the other areas? Or is that just holding the victims of conflict hostage to the principles of humanitarian action? John, over to you.
Well, as I said in the example of Sri Lanka, which I quoted, this becomes extremely difficult and complicated and anguished at times as to how to respond in these situations where you only have partial access and you're dealing with a government or indeed with non-state actors, a rebel movement, whoever, who are not themselves obeying humanitarian principles in any way and are not allowing you to do it very well either. So this is always extremely difficult. As Hugo implied, the default option so far, at least in recent years, has been to try everything to stay engaged and to stay on the ground in order to help people who need help. The fear being that if you withdraw, under pressure from the government, and they very often are putting pressure on you, then the only people you're really pleasing are the government, rather than the people who you're trying to help, because they, you can argue you're going to reach some of them, but reaching some of them is better than not reaching any of them. And this does become really very difficult indeed. But as I say, the default option has been to try to stay in there. Let me give you another example from my experience, which was Darfur again. Again, I think it was 2009 when the government of Sudan expelled from Darfur and indeed from Sudan as a whole for the most part, 13 humanitarian organizations who'd been working there for some years, mostly international NGOs. The UN was allowed to continue to work, but a lot of big international NGOs were expelled, allegedly on the ground that they were engaged in inappropriate activity, espionage or whatever it might be, all of which was nonsense by the way, but that was what the government said. And actually, this was a response to the indictment by the International Criminal Court of the President of Sudan, President Bashir. And again, there was an anguished debate within the humanitarian community about how do you respond to this. This is clearly completely unacceptable behavior by the government. This is reducing the services which we can give to the people on the ground and maybe prejudicing what we can give altogether. However, if we withdraw, are we not essentially in some ways giving the government what they want and deserting the people who are in need? Now, in that particular case, after a lot of debate, we decided again to stay in Darfur to try to fill the gaps that had been left by these expulsions, but also, of course, to try to persuade the government to reverse that policy decision and to try to create a better and a more productive and more effective relationship with the government for the future, an effort which, by the way, failed. So you're still dealing with the same problem as you were before in Darfur, but we have the agency decided to stay. Now, I think that was probably the right decision. I was very much part of it, so I would say that, wouldn't I? But it was quite a difficult one, and you know, there is an argument, which I attach some importance to, that by always or nearly always staying in there, we are giving a signal to government that they can do almost anything they like, and we won't pull out on principle. We won't respect our own principles. We'll just stay in there and try to help people. And I think that is a real problem. Faced with these realities on the ground, the trump card tends to be humanity, the need to try to address people's needs and reduce their suffering. And it's a very, very, only in a very, very serious situation would you withdraw altogether. Individual agencies respond to this in different ways. There are some NGOs which are much more, slightly prejudicial way of putting it, much more principled, shall I say, than others, or much more attached to principles. The ICRC, not an NGO itself, but is, you know, very much at that end of the spectrum. Médecins Sans Frontières, which you know very well, Mark, again, will be very much principled, but also trying to stay in there. Some other organizations are much more pragmatic and much less concerned about the principles and just decide, you know, much more inclined just to do what they can, wherever they can, without worrying too much about the principles of it. This can be even more complicated in areas. I remember also, for example, in the area of the Ogaden, the Somali area of Ethiopia, where the Ethiopian government was extremely reluctant to allow humanitarian organizations to operate because they said, in effect, we were colluding with the rebels down there, the Ogaden Liberation Front, National Liberation Front, UNLF, and giving succor to them by giving the aid. Now, what was actually happening to some extent was that they were also trying to divert aid to friendly villages, not to villages they regarded as hostile. So again, a very difficult problem of how far you stay engaged with the government and how far at a certain point you should pull out. Again, in the end, we have stayed. The situation has probably changed since then, but we stayed and decided to try to make the best of it, to try to persuade the government and, of course, the rebels as well, to themselves respect humanitarian principles and humanitarian organizations, but we decided to put the pragmatic need to help people over the question of principle and some of the violations of principle which were going on there.
Thank you, John. I'm going to come back to you in a moment, I'd very much like to try and understand better from you how organizations, how do they discuss these things internally? You know, what if these are very, very difficult questions, have you, you know, sort of good and bad examples of how organizations deal with them in the course of their humanitarian action? For instance, I think one of the things that's very important is that while we all understand the need to make compromise, those compromises have to be deliberate. My experience is that often organizations have simply become a little bit in the business of delivering assistance and not really recognizing that there are other principles to at least try and fight and defend. And I'm wondering if in your experience you've seen that as well.
So was that addressed to me, Mark?
Yes, I'm sorry. I started that question by saying I was going to come back to you, but you know, it makes sense to just continue on that point a little bit. I'm talking about, you know, how do management teams deal with some of these discussions, and how should they, and what are some examples maybe of where they didn't deal with them internally, even if we understand that the right answer, there's no formula for reaching a supposed right answer.
There is no formula for reaching a right answer, and different organizations will reach different conclusions at different times. I think the worst examples are where NGOs or agencies do things under pressure from donors, because donors have other concerns and start putting pressure on them to withdraw or to keep going or whatever it might be. An example of the kind of concerns that they have, a very current example in many ways, is whether aid organizations are somehow involved with or helping indirectly or directly, deliberately or not deliberately, so-called terrorist organizations. And the American government is the one which is the most guilty of that, if I can put it that way. And I think aid organizations should be very, very chary of being drawn into that debate, however difficult it might be. I think the best way of handling these discussions is in two ways. One is to make it a humanitarian community discussion. In other words, don't keep it all within your agency, but discuss it with others who are facing similar problems and try to reach common solutions, and not to sort of go, you know, bravely go it on your own, but to try to reach common solutions where possible. If you can't, of course, you may have to make your own decision. But I think it's very important that governments who are being difficult about this should not be able to divide and rule. They should be faced with a collective wherever they can. And the second thing is, I think it's very important in these situations, which are difficult and complicated and highly political in some ways, is for organizations to make sure there's a proper debate between headquarters, wherever that might be, and the people who are based in the field, who may have rather different views of these things coming from their different viewpoints. So they need to get together, I mean, physically, if they possibly can, around a table and discuss what's really going on here. What are all the nuances? You have to understand the nuances of the situation as opposed to just you know, what you may be reading in the media at any one time. And I think the organizations which have that sort of field headquarters dialogue and respect the views of the field are the ones which are most likely to reach the right decisions, and the ones where the decisions are being driven purely from the center, from people sitting in chairs a very long way from the action, and perhaps being vulnerable either to press pressure or government pressure or other pressures which are particular to their headquarters, not particularly relevant to what's going on the ground. That's where the decisions get made in the worst way.
Thank you, John. Karen, I want to pick up on something John just said and bring it to you. And that is, you know, at times, if it's known that the humanitarians will almost always compromise in favor of staying and delivering, that has implications in terms of the expectations of the government, and maybe is a disincentive to their looking at principles. It seems to me that the for-profit aid sector would have a completely different approach. That essentially they're under a contractual obligation to stay and deliver. I assume that security issues might get in the way. But do people in the for-profit sector, do the companies there delivering aid worry about impartiality, neutrality, independence, and some of these other principles, or are they almost always going to favor delivery because that's what they're paid to do?
Well, that's a great question, especially if you have the right donor, and I think understanding the donor's needs and desires, and I think that's something that we are, unfortunately, sometimes as contractors don't have the ability to change American foreign policy. If you're getting money from USAID or the State Department and you're working in these areas and you've signed on your contract, but that give and take between the people in the field and the headquarters, and I think that's a great distinction to talk about. The more on the ground understanding of what's going on, the dynamics that continue between the delivery or the groups that you work with, and where you see that assistance benefiting or perhaps bringing in negative activity, comes from that on-the-ground discussion all the time. Unfortunately, there's a large disconnect, I think, precisely with the on-the-ground knowledge and the donor's intent. That could be global because they see things in a very myopic way because they have a different decision than what's happening each and every single day that may be impacting the staff in which they work. And absolutely, security is the number one thing for all organizations. You don't want to see anything happen to your staff because they are, they are the ones who assist you. They know the community better. And without them, you're not able to do your work. So security for all of your workers will be number one consideration. But on that side of whether or not you are delivering aid in some way, shape, or form that is negative, as long as those lines of communication, because you do see how your work may be activities, maybe you're now, let's just say in southern Sudan, part of the work was cleaning up local areas for commercial development, and that would mean paving streets, bringing in more of a marketplace, but then bringing in stoplights. And if all of a sudden now the paving of roads now means that, say up in Darfur, that groups like Janjaweed were able to now roll into communities much faster, because you've improved the transportation aspect of their ability to go and attack villages, then you have to think, what are we really doing? And so those become questions of, are we facilitating negative activities, or are we really meeting the needs and that all communities have under those humanitarian commissions? So is it about delivering aid? Well, you don't want to deliver aid to anywhere if you're now causing political or civil strife within the area in which you're supposed to work.
Thank you, Karen. Thank you very much for giving that example around the Janjaweed, where something that seems positive, like roads, ends up having quite some negative consequences. Hugo, I'd like to go back to you. You, in your lesson, talked about the trump card of humanity. And John Holmes just brought up the very important, I think, real world a potential consequence of that, and that is, if you're playing cards and everyone knows what your trump is, you're going to lose the game. So I guess the question is, how do we get this balance? And are humanitarians, is there a risk that humanitarians are going to lose the power of their cards, the power of the principles, if more and more governments are able to essentially predict that the humanitarians will back down on principle after a little bit of huffing and puffing, let's say?
Yeah, it's an important point. Getting back to what you were discussing with John and Karen a little is the question which in ethics would be called deliberation, how you think clearly and deliberately about difficult moral choices you face. And I'm just going to give John's book a plug here, because actually his book, The Politics of Humanity, is a really clear and very accessible window into how he deliberated and others deliberated over some of the very difficult situations. So I would urge people to read that book, because it's very clear and it addresses deliberation at the very top senior level of politics and on the ground where things are really happening. So that would be a helpful text, I think, for people to look at. In terms of this Trump question, I see what you mean, that if people think we're always going to default to staying and delivering over being very principled, that is a problem. I think the truth is, to go back to John's point and say, really try and work together on this so that you can present a united front on issues, you can find strength in numbers if possible. And the other aspect that Karen's brought up is that you have to think of consequences of being there and staying there, and you have to weigh these things up ethically. And I know everyone listening does this probably every day. But the Trump, I think, is a good one. I mean, I think it's good that humanity is prioritized, that we understand that what we're trying to do and the goal of our project is to save lives and respect the human person. And we should be very clear that that's very important to us in our negotiations. And we should be demanding it of others with whom we're negotiating. We should demand the same humanity from them. And of course, that's very complicated sometimes. But that's certainly what the ICRC would do in all its negotiations. But as I said, there will be times when we feel that the kind of things we're able to do are either simply not enough, or counterproductive, or affecting our credibility along the other lines of our principles like neutrality and independence. In other words, affecting our long-term credibility in the eyes of people we're dealing with, or in the eyes of the world. So we do make very strong stands sometimes. We've certainly done it around our detention work in a couple of countries where we've issued a public statement saying, because of the approach and attitude of the authorities here, we cannot deliver on our humanitarian mandate. We see no way to do this in any meaningful way, or neutrally and impartially and independently, and therefore we're stopping at the moment. And of course, as John's pointed out about Sudan, governments sometimes make that decision for us, and we're asked to stop our activities for a period. So we have a trump. I think that trump is a good one to show people, to say that this is the focus of our profession. This is the goal and purpose. But I would agree, we have to be resolute sometimes on the other principles if the situation means that we're really just doing very little or very bad humanitarian action.
Thank you, Hugo. I just want to call your attention, there's a poll there now that asks whether humanitarian organizations today are at risk of focusing too much on assistance delivery, regardless of the circumstances. And we've got about 26 people who have come back on that. But really, it'd be really interesting to get you, the participants, get your input on this. What is the perception? Are organizations too focused on assistance delivery? I'm going to come to you now, Andy. We've got a few comments out there that come back to the military role. And Tim, I'm going to have to paraphrase this question, but he essentially sees that the military have already become very involved in humanitarian assistance and incorporated this as a Western military technique, the delivery of assistance. But, kind of makes the allegation that it's due to this that other humanitarian agencies have troubles with access because, of course, it creates doubts and distrust among, for instance, the enemies of the Western military. So that, that push of humanity, that feeling of compassion for people, brings the military to act in a way that then causes distrust of the humanitarian sector. Juan actually asks if it goes even further, if we're in real danger where after a while it's the military will sort of take over relief and leave truly humanitarian actors outside. I don't know if you could handle those, Andy.
Thank you. This question has to be phrased or set in the, it is a very context specific issue. And whether or not even requesting, and it is at the request of, in many instances, if we take the non-conflict environment first, it is at the request of the affected state that, generally speaking, nations will respond. And if it could be that, it's the appropriateness of that response, and obviously, we are extremely cognizant of the Oslo guidelines and how they are applied. I'm not aware of any conversations that would suggest that the military is viewed as a replacement for humanitarian actors. I remind when I go and do training serials and whatever with militaries of various that remind them that they're not humanitarian actors, and there are others out there who are far more qualified in order to deliver the need that they're being asked to deliver. So I'm not aware that there is a move in that general direction. But I think it is fair to say that there is, I come back to the word in extremis, that there is, particularly in complex emergencies, that there may well be a place where the only course of action in order to alleviate suffering, try and meet the need, where military actors are in a position to respond. But I stress that, certainly that's viewed, in my understanding, as an extremis. It has been done in the past. And I wouldn't necessarily like to think of environments where it would be done in the future. But nevertheless, it does provide options, shall we say. But, that there is, I think, the onus on us to better prepare any military for any potential responses in the future by training and actually having this discussion with them so that they understand where the humanitarian community is coming from. I think a lot of the stereotypes of the past, and you alluded to this earlier, Mark, I think those have moved on, and I think we can have that discussion find my key role is that of defending humanitarian space and getting everybody to understand whether they have a role in a particular response, and if we do, what that role looks like.
Thank you, Andy. I'd like to, we've got, just to let everyone know, we've got about 15 minutes left, so I'd ask that we try, if you have any last questions, try and get them in now so that we can process them, and if the panelists today can try and keep their answers relatively short, I think we've been doing a good job of that already. Karen, I'd like to raise this topic. Hugo talked about how humanity and giving a meaning to that principle of humanity inside the ICRC brings us to the conclusion that what a humanitarian organization is supposed to be delivering to people isn't just assistance, it's assistance and protection. And I'm just wondering, does the for-profit sector have any policies or practices, or even just, you know, sort of understanding around its role in terms of protection?
Absolutely. I think one of the things probably unknown is how much this training, especially when anyone goes out to the field from a for-profit firm, that you discuss what you're doing, the intentions, and the idea that the work that you're doing is I use the term professionalism because I think so many people have good intentions, but when it's not done in the correct way, through the myriad of lessons learned, we forget that simple delivering of aid in the appropriate way, or the way in which that we've agreed upon throughout all of our communities is done. If it's done in the wrong way, we are going to be hurting those that we serve. For the protection side, absolutely, and I'll give you an example. A lot of the work that has been done, especially in places like Libya, and I'm just thinking of the recent places, Libya and Yemen, when we work, and for-profit firms are out there just as much. They do have a humanitarian-esque, if that's, you know, instead of saying, they just have a mission, and that mission is to provide the health care, because they will go out there, and a lot of times, and this is based on donors, some will give money because they have a specific need in mind, and when donors sign on to a contract versus a grant or a cooperative agreement, when you can direct exactly where and how the assistance will be given and what will be done, some donors prefer that rather than just allowing someone to come back and to agree with their approach. The donor wants their approach to be given. So if that approach increases and brings in the protection side, absolutely. In Yemen, for a specific, a lot of the consternation with the provider on the ground with their donor was that the donor was asking them to do things that would put the communities in danger, because again, this whole thing about anti-terrorism, getting all these forms signed from different people, and what it was doing was, instead of having a very indirect relationship, now wanted a very formalized relationship with these organizations, and it was putting them at risk. So this had to be discussed at the ground level and brought up to headquarters, because the approach that the donor thought would work was actually something that was harming individuals by forcing them to sign these forms to say that they were anti-terrorist, and it was very difficult. And that's one thing I think Sir John was saying, is that sometimes we're, through all of this, the aspect of what we do to deliver aid actually leaves little protection for those who are getting it from us. And one thing I just wanted to add to Andy's statements, Mark, if you allow me just a couple of seconds, on the training piece. In the interagency process throughout the US government, that understanding of how CIVNIL works inside of humanitarian operations, we have a class that's run by the US Institute of Peace called JHOC, led by USAID. Since USAID is our leading agency to deliver humanitarian assistance, all those who want to participate and work in the humanitarian crisis sector inside the military and interagency are requested and almost required to take the JHOT course, or Joint Humanitarian Operations course, which helps to separate for the military and for the civilian actors what the military does and does not do during humanitarian operations, what are the humanitarian principles, and it's a great course for a week. So if anyone's out there and hasn't taken this great class for the civmil actors and what's being done in the interagency community with all the partners, I would suggest those to sign up. And sometimes they do traveling stuff, but it's a good course, at least for those who will be engaging in U.S. assistance in humanitarian operations. Thank you.
All right. Thank you, Karen, for that answer and for the plug of that course. That sounds very interesting. John, I'd like to come back to you with this issue of assistance. And I want to say it perhaps in a wrong way, assistance versus protection. And I want to say that to kind of get at one of my experiences when I was working inside MSF is that the principle of humanity always seemed to come down on the side of delivering aid to people. And that was often juxtaposed against trying to do protection work for people, which might have involved, for instance, advocacy and public speaking, those other things that might antagonize a government and therefore impair or otherwise place an obstacle in the delivery of assistance. And I'm wondering, how because they should both come from the principle of humanity, assistance and protection, and yet they sometimes seem to be in opposition due to the way in which governments manipulate the humanitarian community. Any comments there on how you've seen that play out?
Yes, it is a tricky issue. Very often governments, difficult governments, don't mind you giving out stuff, food or water or medical care or whatever, not least because it saves them the expense of doing it themselves, if you want to be cynical about it. So they don't have a real problem with that if you're doing that because somebody else is paying, and it doesn't have the same political connotations. But then governments very often do have a problem with you doing what is called protection work, in other words, where you're looking at the treatment of individuals in the circumstances when in the round, and you're looking at whether they're being abused sexually or in human rights terms, and you're advising them of their rights, and you can very often and very quickly seem to be taking up a position against the government, particularly if the government is as much part of the problem as part of the solution. So it becomes much more political to do protection work than it is to do straightforward disaster relief or emergency relief. And some organizations, therefore, will migrate towards the things which are a bit easier to deal with rather than doing the protection work. So I think that's one sort of angle on it. A second angle is a little bit more complicated, which is the long-running debate about, well, what is protection work? Protection of civilians has become a very ready watchword for humanitarians, and there are many situations where NGOs and others deploy protection officers. And this causes a primary confusion about what a protection officer is, because in another context, it's a bodyguard, and that's not a very helpful term in a way. But just leaving that aside, just to give you an example, my observation in some of these conflict situations, and Darfur was an example, that there were a lot of protection officers, but not much protection. And that's partly because actually you're in danger of selling a false prospectus in saying we're doing protection work, because you cannot physically protect people. That's not what you're there for. You're not an armed unit deliberately. You're not using physical force to stand between the people who are suffering and the people who are abusing them. You can document and you can inform and you can advocate and you can advise people of their rights, et cetera, and those are all useful things. But at the end of the day, it's very hard to actually protect them. And therefore, you're in danger, as I say, of being slightly on a false perspective. So this is another angle to the same question about whether what is the right balance between the two. Now, ideally, you should, in many situations, you will want to be doing a combination of both. You need to give people physically what they need rather than delivering moral lectures to them. when they're suffering from lack of food, water, and medical care. So you need to get the basics right first, but also you need to be very cognizant in while you're doing that of their more longer-term fundamental needs to be treated as properly as human beings, to have their rights respected. Now, another problem which arises with this is that what is the distinction when you get into this kind of area between a human rights organization and a humanitarian organization? Humanitarian organizations are driven, in a sense, obviously, by human rights principles, humanity being the foremost among them, but they're not human rights organizations, which don't deliver aid and are operating in a slightly more theoretical, abstract way, and can be very often much more powerful in their condemnation of what's going on in a particular situation, because they're not engaged on the ground in the way that humanitarian organizations are. Now, there is a risk always that humanitarian organizations will drift into becoming as much human rights organizations as humanitarian organizations, in that they will favor advocacy over actual assistance. So I think that's wrong if they go that way. I think that's not their strength. They shouldn't be going too much to advocacy and not basing it on the ground assistance. On the other hand, as I say, assistance by itself, just the physical stuff of shelter and so on, may well not be enough, and you need to add something to that. But there is a little bit of a fan for protection, which doesn't always translate into really effective action on the ground as well.
All right. Thank you, John. I think, Andy, I'd like to go back to you one last time, and then I'm going to give the final word to Hugo before I break off. I'm going to give us all about five more minutes here. It's currently four, and we're scheduled for four, but maybe just go a little bit further. And Andy, getting some comments around, that this issue of protection often comes up with in humanitarian context where there are peacekeeping missions. And peacekeeping missions obviously have a different mandate than, a national military, for instance, the UK military. And often protection is part of that mandate, but it's not protection, in the terms of writing advocacy reports and things like that. But I'm wondering, where do you see the issues around that peacekeeping protection, and then what we're talking about, the kind of protection of, being practiced by humanitarian actors? John mentioned the obvious one. Humanitarian actors don't have guns and can't actually deliver on the physical safety of people. But beyond that, are there differences that we should be aware of?
Sure. I mean, I think that the first thing that's already been alluded to is one of language, and protection in its pure form to a member of the military does not mean what the same as protection to somebody working in the humanitarian community. So I think, firstly, we need to ensure that we're speaking on the same page, and there is the onus is on the military to actually understand what is meant by protection, and then collaboratively, if one can, whatever, to actually ascertain whether there's a role within that and within that mission for them to take something on. There is far greater awareness now within militaries of protection issues, of vulnerable groups, protection and violence against women and girls. These are subjects that militaries are talking about and are thinking about. So I think there is movement in that general direction. But I think the primary thing is to ensure that we all understand the terminology.
Thank you, Andy. Hugo, I'd like to finish with you. I'm very glad we were able to talk today about your favorite principle, and I'm wondering, stick you on this theme of assistance and protection. How does ICRC differentiate between or balance those two concrete manifestations of humanity when in fact they come into tension? And I guess a sub question of that is, well, maybe not for ICRC, but is an organization able to say, we uphold the principle of humanity, But we're just going to deliver assistance. We're not going to involve ourselves in any of that protection work. Is that good enough to be in compliance with that principle as a humanitarian actor?
Good. Thank you, Mark. Well, in terms of ICRC's commitment to protection and assistance, we prioritize both extremely hard, and they are, in a sense, for us, totally joint objectives. So we have protection delegates, as some of you may know, who are working on very specific groups of people, whether they're detainees or civilian populations or particular caseloads that we work on very closely. And I suppose we are able, because of our status internationally, to have very direct conversations with authorities about these people. So that is always a focus for us, protection, and reminding authorities of their obligations under international humanitarian law to protect people and particular categories of protected persons. So the two for us are very, very much a joint focus of our work. And the other thing that, as some have hinted already, of course, if you're doing assistance well, you are often in the way you design assistance programs, the way you listen to what people need, when they need it, what the kind of thing they need is. You can design assistance programs that are also protective to a degree, so you do not expose people to greater risk and vulnerability to violence or danger of different kinds. So we're very focused on both those two things, and we find them both seriously prioritized in international humanitarian law in various articles of the conventions and protocols. In your second question is, can you be humanitarian if you're only doing assistance? We started with the definition of humanity from the fundamental principles of the Red Cross, which is to relieve human suffering wherever it may be found and to protect life, health, and ensure respect for the human being. So in a sense, you have to do all those things. And every humanitarian act is at once ideally an act of protection and protection and assistance sometimes. So I think, I'm not going to say that somebody who is leading a fantastic food aid program or an ATM-based cash transfer program is not a humanitarian because they're largely engaged in assistance activity. I don't find that convincing because they're also in that process trying to ensure respect for the human person, that person has entitlements to income, to a level of dignified living. So I think we don't need to separate them too much. I think in humanitarian acts, a humanitarian act is one that saves lives and respects the human person. And I think that often happens in assistance programs, and it can happen in protection programs too. So I don't think we need to start saying that there are half humanitarians and whole humanitarians. I think in the best kind of humanitarian act, we are saving life and respecting the dignity of the human person.
That's a great final note. Thank you very much for that answer. Well, we've come to the end of a very interesting 2 hours and certainly an interesting panel discussion. I hope everyone out there has enjoyed it, learned something. As mentioned, today's discussion was part of a series of events on the humanitarian principles. Today we talked about humanity. But I hope you'll join us for the next upcoming sessions as well. Our next event is on September 24th in the same time slot. We're talking about impartiality. And then on October 1st, neutrality. And on October 6th, independence. And we'll be using the same format where we'll have a lesson to start and then a panel discussion. I want to thank everyone put two hands together and clap wherever they're standing or sitting in the world. For Karen Walsh, Andy Hill, Hugo Slim, and John Holmes, you've done a wonderful job, and I really think we've had a very interesting discussion. And best of luck to and thank you for your participation, and best of luck to everyone in their work, and we hope to see you the next time. Good day.